So right now, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Rosemary Allen. Dr. Rosemary Allen began teaching at MSU Denver in 2004. Her research interests are related to addressing the disproportionate number of children of color expelled and suspended from early childhood programs through culturally responsive teaching. Dr. Allen consults with early childhood leaders on culturally responsive practices, microaggressions, and facing personal bias and privilege. Rosemary has a black belt in Taekwondo. Don't mess with her. She loves hiking, reading, and traveling with her family. They actually just returned from Belize and is headed to Southwest Asia in January. She has two children, a daughter, Jasmine, is a psychologist, and Clarence just graduated from Howard University. Congratulations, I'm sure you're proud. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Rosemary Allen.
Thank you so much for the welcome. It is so exciting always to be in the presence of those who work on behalf of young children. So thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. I'm going to talk to you today about preschool suspensions and expulsions. Let's see if I can get this to work. Disproportionality and suspensions and expulsions, why we should all care. So I'd like to start with a quote, one of my favorites, by James Baldwin. And it says, "For these are all of our children. We will either profit from or pay for whoever they become." And I'd just like to repeat that. It says, "For these are all of our children, and all of us will either pay for or profit by who they become." So, let's start with some of the not so exciting things in terms of definitions. What is disproportionality? And disproportionality is when one group is either overrepresented or underrepresented in a particular situation or category, depending on the population of that group in general. And when we talk about suspensions, you know, there's no federal overlying definition of suspensions, but this is the best one that I found. And it said it's a disciplinary action that's administered as a consequence of a child's behavior that's been deemed inappropriate. And it requires that that student absence him or herself from a classroom or from a school for a specific period of time. And what I'd like to say is that that's a pretty narrowly defined description, and it doesn't encompass everything that we know we experience in our schools. For instance, excluding a child from the learning process for one or more days, that's a pretty typical one. Another one is if this child is excluded from the classroom. And then an out-of-school suspension means you can't come on the premises. Please leave the premises and don't come back. But we rarely talk about the type of suspension that happens when a child is sent home early. When the schools don't want a suspension on their record, and they say, "Oh, you know, Claire is having a rough day today. Why don't you come and pick her up after lunchtime?" Or when students are asked to change programs because it's not a good fit. Perhaps the programs down the street would be better for them. So, when we look at suspensions, we have to look back. And one of the very first suspension studies took place in 1975 by the Children's Defense Fund. And what we found was those years that followed the Brown versus Board of Education decision, the suspension rates for black students tripled compared to those of whites. And during those few years following Board of Education, there were approximately 22 per 100 white students who were suspended, compared to 76 per 100 black students. I'm going to do something you very rarely hear a woman do on stage in front of over 1,100 people, and that is tell you my age. I was born in 1959. So I was a Brown versus Board of Education decision baby. I came of age. I was in elementary school during those years following this. And I have to tell you that I also was a victim of exactly what I'm talking about. Having been suspended from school at least 5 to 7, 10 times a year from the day I walked into kindergarten. This is very personal to me because it's very real to me. It happens. And I was suspended so often that they put me on a modified schedule. And then they decided that perhaps I needed to be in special ed. And way back then, some of you might remember, they conducted an IQ test to see if you qualify. So they gave me an IQ test, and my IQ was off the chart. So they thought, okay, she doesn't qualify for special ed. What are we going to do with her? And they skipped me a grade. So I went from third grade to fifth grade. And they thought that would work, and it didn't, because I was still very active and very talkative, and those are the things I got in trouble for. Talking too much, being disruptive. You know, some of you are very familiar with that because I'm sure you experienced it. But after that, they wanted to skip me another grade, but I have a sister who's 2 years older, and my dad didn't think it was good for either one of us. And then he said something that we've come to embrace. Here's my dad, this old Southern man with an eighth grade education, and he said, why don't you meet her where she is? Why don't you give her what she needs right where she is? And that's how I was saved. And people often wonder, how is it that you made it so far, having gotten into so much trouble as a kid? And it's because I had a family who believed in me. And I had a family who supported me. And I had a family who went to bat for me at every single turn. So anyway, when we look at suspensions over 40 years of suspension studies show us that African Americans are up to 4 times more likely to be suspended and expelled than white students. There's been a lot of research on suspensions, but when we look at it, most of it focuses on kindergarten through 12th grades. There are very few disciplinary studies over this 40-year period that really looks at children who are younger than 5, or 5 and younger. So, our 2014 Civil Rights Data Collection for the first time included preschool data, and it looked at the number of preschool children who had at least one out-of-school suspension, who had more than one suspension, who was expelled, and who received corporal punishment. And just as a side note, my newest research is really focusing on this corporal punishment piece because we haven't really taken a good look at it. We haven't looked at how many children are hit in American schools. And sooner or later, we're going to have to look at that because I do believe that corporal punishment and suspensions, they're all intertwined and you really can't separate them out. And what's surprising about corporal punishment as well is that it shows the same patterns of disproportionality as suspensions. So what the data showed from that collection study is that 5,000 preschoolers were suspended at least once, another 2,500 the second time, that there were patterns of racial and gender disproportionality. Boys, 79% of the preschool population, 82% of suspensions. There were patterns of gender disproportionality, race, African Americans were 18% of the preschool population, but 48% of those who were suspended. So if you were to cut that pie, you would have, into 5 pieces, you'd have 1/5 of that pie that make up African-American children, and nearly half of the pie are those who are suspended. It also showed children with disabilities were suspended. And then we have our new OCR data that showed basically the same patterns of racial and gender disproportionality. Our boys are suspended. Boys are suspended a lot. They make up nearly half of the preschool population, but more than 2/3 of those who are suspended. Again, African-American preschoolers were nearly 4 times more likely to be suspended than their white peers. And African-American girls, and this is startling, especially when you look at how young it started, they're only 20% of the preschool population, preschool female population, but more than half of girls who are suspended. Goes back to some of my experiences, right? A little PTSD there. So, it also showed that children with disabilities are not disproportionately suspended from preschool, but they are K through 12. And it showed that English language learners are not disproportionately suspended from preschool. So, that's from our OCR data, and it's only looking at this very small population of publicly funded preschool. There are certain states, various states, who have conducted their own suspension studies, and this is what they found. In Illinois, 40% of the state's child care programs suspended infants and toddlers. So we're looking at babies who are still in diapers that are being suspended from school. In North Dakota, 20% of programs expel children. Of those who were expelling, this is saying you can't ever come back, 53% of those were infants and toddlers. So this is happening very, very early. When we talk about our preschool prison pipeline, you usually hear school to prison, but this starts very early before children are even walking. Do you know that you can have a child kick out of 3 or 4 child care centers before they ever enter kindergarten? And by the time they get to kindergarten, they have already learned that school is not a safe space for them. Some of the outcomes of being suspended is that, of course, you all probably already know this, that there's a disconnect from school. You totally disengage from the learning process. You're more likely to end up in juvenile hall. You're more likely to have low achievement. You're more likely to drop out of school, to become a violent criminal. I mean, there's just so much. And it's happening before children even learn to talk. We are very familiar with Dr. Walter Gilliam's 2005 suspension study, and it showed that preschoolers, and this is again just public programs, they're suspended 3 times more than kindergarten through 12th grades combined. So preschoolers are kicked out of school a lot. A Colorado discipline study showed that 10 per 1,000 were suspended. A Boulder County and Colorado suspension study showed that children were suspended at a rate of 13 per 1,000. And for those who were in family child care homes, it went up to 69 per 1,000. In New Hampshire, 10 per 115. In Michigan, the preschool suspension rate was 27 per 1,000, and that was 34 times more than the rate for kindergarten to 12th grade. So, disproportionality occurs in situations other than suspensions. We see disproportionate numbers of children of color who are sent to the office for classroom discipline. They're being sent home early. They're being sent to other classrooms. And unfortunately, in urban schools across this country, you can walk through them and see especially boys of color being sent out into the hallways. They're just sitting there. And when we talk about the achievement gap, or more appropriately, the opportunity gap, how can children learn if they're removed from the learning process so often? We have to begin to wonder about how this impacts all children. One of the things I want to say is when a child is suspended from school, it not only impacts that child, but it impacts that child's family. Unlike children getting suspended older, preschoolers, and now we know infants and toddlers, someone has to be there to take care of them. So are parents losing their jobs because their child is being sent home early? I worked for the state for a number of years, and just recently I got a call from my former assistant, and she was being called about 3 times a week to pick her child up from school. 3 times a week for her 4-year-old to be picked up. Good thing she had a boss who really understood if she could, the school was close by, she could pick him up and she could bring him back to work with her. But what happens to parents who don't have that option? And then I wonder about the added stress on the parents when this happens. And then I worry about what that stress might do to the parent-child relationship. And then I wonder if, what if these parents don't have the skills that they need to address this behavior under this very stressful situation? Are suspensions leading to child abuse? That's the way my mind wanders. It just, what if? When I said earlier, this is something we all have to be concerned about, we all have to be concerned about it. But not only does the suspension impact the child and the family, but it impacts every other child in that classroom. Because when we suspend children, when we have that child that is the problem child, and I taught 3-year-olds for 5 years. It took a number of years to rejuvenate my brain cells after that. But back then, we had children segregated. We had a 2-year-old classroom, and we have a 3-year-old classroom. We don't do that anymore, do we? Because 3-year-olds need to be with 2s and 4s. I mean, we need 4-year-olds to kind of help us out a little bit, especially some of those 4-year-olds who are in leadership positions who can say, you're not supposed to do that right now. But as a 3-year-old teacher, there were children, well, let me back up. I'm going to say what all teachers say. I love all my kids. But there were some that just wore me out. That just got on my nerve, if I could be honest. We're in a room of professionals, right? Every now and then you have that child you don't click with. And for me, it was Connor. Connor, stop. Connor, don't. Connor, come over here. Connor, sit in my lap. Connor, let me hold your hand. It was Connor. And you know, what I didn't realize was that I was teaching every child in my classroom that Connor was the problem child. So much so that there was a ruckus once over in the block area. Blocks went tumbling, kids went screaming and crying, and what happened? What's going on over there? And one of the children said, Connor did it. And Connor wasn't there that day. But do you see what happened? I trained them to blame Connor for everything. So when a child is being suspended, is being disproportionately disciplined, we're teaching other children how to treat that child. And not only that, we are teaching them that some children are disposable. Some children get to stay while others have to go. And those studies that span 40 years, they have shown us that the behavior of these children of color is no different than the behaviors of white children. So what message are we sending that some children can behave a certain way and stay, and some children can do some of those same things and be asked to leave? So we have to ask ourselves, why is this happening? I'm trying to be fancy there. So, one of the underlying reasons is this thing we all heard about that makes us all very, very uncomfortable, and it's implicit bias. So what is implicit bias? I can show you better than I can tell you, but I love this ladder of inference, although it's not really connected with implicit bias, but it seems to kind of illustrate my point. And if we look at this ladder, we know we start at the bottom, and at the bottom it says, I select data from what I observe. And once I select the data, then I add meaning to it. And then I make assumptions based on it. And then I draw conclusions. And then I adopt beliefs about the world. And then I take actions based on those beliefs. Let's see how this plays out. Starting at the bottom, it takes milliseconds to complete, and we're often totally unaware that we're doing it. It's a process by which we determine and make meaning of what's happening, and this process can make everything visible for us. So let me show you. I select data. Rosemarie just passed right by me, and she didn't even speak. And let me tell you, speaking is cultural. Most people don't think about that, but speaking is cultural. Some people, some of you in this room, were intentionally taught to speak when you enter a room. Anybody? When you enter a room, you speak. In my family, when you come in, you speak and hug everyone in that room. Everyone. If I ever want to get in trouble, in my house, I'm from a large extended family, so when I came home, every auntie, uncle, and cousin can be there, right? But this really refers to adults. So if I come home and my mom is sitting down with a couple of her sisters, the first thing I have to do is go, hi, Auntie Trina. Hi, Auntie Pam. Hi, Auntie Cora. That was the rule. Now, if I didn't do that, if I walked in and went, hey, girl, get back in here. Do you see your aunties? What is wrong with you? What makes you think you can walk in this house and not speak? That's the rule, it's cultural. So imagine this is me. You walk right by, you rush by, and you didn't speak. I will add meaning and label based on my own cultural and personal perspective. Huh, look at her. She's got an attitude. I knew she didn't like me. And then I'm gonna make some assumptions. Huh, she thinks she's better than everybody because she's a teacher and I'm just an assistant. And then I draw conclusions. You know what? We'll never be treated fairly by her because she thinks she's better. She doesn't even speak when she walks in the room. You see how fast that happens? But it happens very, very quickly. It actually happened to me in my three-year-old classroom quite often because I was taught to speak when you walk in a room. And I expect the children to walk in the room and speak. So a child will come in with the mom or dad, and I say, good morning, Tiffany. And Tiffany. I said, Tiffany, good morning. And then her mother would say something that I just could not believe based on my own personal preference. And she'd go, I guess you don't feel like speaking this morning. And in my mind, it's like, I didn't know she had a choice. Truly. Let's look at another one. I select data. I noticed that child didn't address me as Ms. Allen. Again, how you address people is personal and cultural. In my family, anybody taller than you had a title. Auntie, uncle, Mr., Mrs., and then it got to a point where teachers didn't want to be called Mrs. and by their last name. They wanted to be called Rosemarie, they wanted to be called Terry, they wanted to be called Christine. So all of a sudden, this little three-year-old is calling me Rosemarie. I mean, can you imagine for years and years and years, anyone taller than me, I have to call by a title, and here's a three-year-old going, hey, Rosemarie! I'm like, oh. So then it became Teacher Rosemarie. That we couldn't say yes, but they had to have a title. Just let me tell you that some of you are, again, it's not good or bad, right or wrong, it's just different. And some of you are okay with this. And some of you work with people and you meet their children and they say, here is Miss Katrina. And you say, oh, don't call me Miss, just call me Katrina. Please don't do that. Because you know what? If my children, when they were little, went to and called someone Katrina, they would be in really big trouble, and they would be seen as very disrespectful. We have to respect the culture and preferences of the parents that we work with. So when I told teachers all the time, they say, oh, don't call me Mr. Josh, just call me Josh. I say, he's gotta call you something other than Josh. What would you like, Mr. Josh or Teacher Josh, but you're gonna have a title, and you get to choose which one it is. You're gonna have one. So, here I am. This child didn't address me as Miss Allen. I add meaning. That's disrespectful. Then I make assumptions. That family didn't teach that child any manners whatsoever. And then I draw conclusions. I'm not going to really get to know that child because I don't value the fact that the parents didn't teach them any manners. This happens all the time. In a little bit, we're going to talk about cultural disconnects, but I'll tell you mine related to this. In my family, when an adult calls you, you come. And if you can't make it to them, then you say, coming. So my dad, Rose, and I go, coming. Yes, that's the way it goes. So imagine my surprise when I went to go work at a school and I called a child, Connor, what? Like, oh my goodness, huh? And I said, Connor, what? And then I realized that all the children there answered what? It was a disconnect. It wasn't rude. It wasn't disrespectful. It wasn't good or bad or right or wrong. It was just different. That's what happened. So this bias, do you see where I'm going with the bias? And our bias is based on our inability to understand that our own culture and personal preferences do not translate to everyone and everybody. It's just different. And when it doesn't translate, then we begin to create biases around them. But it's also one of the factors that promote inequality in our society and in our schools today. It's important that we understand the causes of implicit bias and that we do intentional work to make sure that we diminish bias in ourselves. So this is what happens. We have these negative symbolic attitudes that lead to implicit bias, that creates prejudice and stereotyping, that then leads to discrimination, and then that discrimination leads to injustices and inequality in our society. Implicit bias resides in our unconscious minds. We don't even know that it's there. And we have to accept that every one of us are biased because we breathe in the biased air, because we're so different and we don't always get a chance to talk about our differences. Do you know that we know very, very, very little about each other in terms of our culture? Simply because we don't talk about it. We've been taught to look at people and say, we're all the same, we're all the same, I don't see color. When you don't see color, you don't see me. I even had a person once come up to me and say, Rosemary, you know, I don't even notice you're black. Well, you didn't say you didn't notice I'm white. So you're noticing somehow, right? That I am black. And this is perfectly okay. It's okay to notice that I am black because that means that you see me. That means that you will understand the trauma that I used to go through. Not anymore. But there was a day about 5 years ago I would have gone through the trauma of, do I straighten my hair to stand before you today? Or is it okay for me to be natural? That's the trauma of black women and black hair. When I worked for state government, I would never wear my hair like this. I was a little younger too, because I wear it like this anywhere I want to wear it now. In this room who still have to struggle with that because it's deemed too ethnic. And when you see me, you will understand what it means for me to be a black mother of a black son and some of those fears. And when you see me, you will understand some of the things that I go through. Let me just tell you something. And I can tell you stories all day, so I'm watching my timer over here. But I live in a predominantly white neighborhood. And 22 years ago, three of us on our cul-de-sac had babies. And when they were about 2 months old, we were all on the cul-de-sac. We're looking at each other's babies and we're cooing over them. And my white neighbor, her son's name is James. And I said, James has the most beautiful blue eyes. I've never seen blue eyes quite that blue. They were about the blue of the lightest color here. And she said, yes, they are. And I think they'll stay. Okay. And I went on to the next thing, but that was the strangest remark I'd ever heard in my life. so strange, I went in the house and I said to my husband, you know, I was talking to so-and-so and said something about big blue eyes, and she said, she thinks they'll stay. He goes, oh, honey, you must have heard her wrong. Where are they going? I said, I didn't hear her wrong. I know what she said because it was so odd, and she said it with so much pride. I just didn't get it. I don't understand that. He goes, honey, you heard her wrong. I'm thinking, no, I didn't. So I called my girlfriend, and I have to tell you, you have to have friends of different ethnicities and different cultures that you can call and ask questions you would never ask anybody else. So I called her, and I said, this is what I heard. What did she mean by that? And my girlfriend said, oh, Rosemarie, you know all babies are born with blue eyes and then they change. No. How in the world would I know that? Because my baby wasn't born with blue eyes. And I said, what do you mean they'll change? Change to what? And she said, they'll change colors. Like, can they change like to brown? She goes, Rosemarie, are you kidding me? No. So you can be born with eyes that blue, and they can change to brown all by themselves? I mean, and some of you who grew up with this, you're probably thinking, surely she's kidding, but we don't talk about this. I've never had a white baby. I don't know. I mean, it was just so amazing to me. And then I had to ask all those questions that we never ask anyone. Like, do they go to bed one night, they're blue, and then they open up and they're brown? How does this work? And then later in the conversation, I found out something else that was so amazing to me. Hair does the same thing. You can be born with blonde hair, and it can turn dark, 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 almost black. Look at your face. You're like, really? Thank you. Of each other. We don't talk about race, and our refusal to talk about it can reinforce certain biases. So implicit bias is this mental process that results in feelings and attitudes about people based on how they feel. And these attitudes are developed over the course of our lifetime. So something happens to you, it's recorded. Someone says something to you, it's recorded. You have a really bad experience with one person, from who's perceived different from you, and it's recorded. And those recordings, over and over and over and over, they result in this implicit bias. Another quick story. My husband and I were very intentional during our engagement. We decided how we would raise our children, how we would conduct our finances, all of that. But we also decided that we would create an anti-bias household, that we will not raise children based on stereotypes and things like that, that we just wouldn't have those negative discussions in our home. So we're driving to visit a friend who's an hour and a half away. Actually, the friend is from Afghanistan and she was having a party. And we were on our way there. And on our way there, wait, I need to back up a little bit. Anyone here from California? Okay, a lot of Californians. I'm also born and raised in California, although I've been in Denver for 23 years. In California, back then, there was a stereotype, an awful stereotype, that said, that promoted Asians were bad drivers. Have you ever heard that? That was so big in California before we left that some insurance companies were being sued because they increased insurance rates for Asian drivers. That's how bad it was. So, my husband and I and my son, who was then about 3.5, 4 years old, in the back seat, we're driving to visit our friend, and all of a sudden, a person stopped in the middle of the highway going 60 miles an hour to put their signal light on to change lanes. I can't even describe for you, even right now my heart is racing reliving this. I can't describe the sheer panic and chaos that ensued as a result. All of a sudden, cars were going everywhere, in and out, turning. It was the most frightening experience in my entire life. My husband is 6'3", about 270 pounds. I call him my gentle giant, my cuddly teddy bear. Never heard him scream or yell or cuss until that moment. And then, what the? Did you even see that? What in the world? And I'm looking at
at this person, like, who are you? And then he goes, I bet it was an Asian. I bet it was an Asian. And I'm looking at him like, what is happening to you? But I knew right then and there was not the time to remind him that we were not going to be doing this. So I kind of sat back and listened. I'm checking on my son, making sure he's okay. And my daughter, she's away in college by this time. And he's just kept going, I can't believe it. I beg you. I beg you. And he's just going nuts. And by the time we straighten ourselves up and everyone on the highway is screaming up, we drive by that driver who's still sitting there with the signal light on. And it just so happened, the lady was Asian. Which wasn't a good thing, because what it did was really get him going again. I told you it was an Asian. And just going on and on and on. But I'm laughing about this, but it really bothered me because I knew something was being recorded on my son's inner recording. And I just didn't like it at all. But again, that wasn't the time to try to figure it out because he was up there. So the next day or two, I thought, we have to address this because we don't do this in our home. We don't stereotype people. So I said, honey, do you remember when we were on our way to Fahima's house?
He goes, yes!
I can't believe it! I thought, okay, still not the time. So about a week later, I said, honey, remember when we were on our way to Fahima's and that person stopped and he goes, babe, I've never been more afraid in my life. I thought I was gonna lose my family. And I said, I could tell you were scared because you reacted in a way I'd never seen. I'd never seen you that upset. I've never seen you that afraid. And in your fear, you know, you engaged in some pretty negative stereotypes about people that really makes me concerned. Makes me concerned about Clarence, our son. And he goes, he didn't hear me. I'm like, I think he heard you. And I think it's recorded. He's gone to enough of my sessions to know what I talk about. I said, I think it's recorded. And he goes, well, I don't think so. And I said, the reality is that we have to refrain from that. No matter how upset we get, no matter how afraid we get, no matter what happens, we cannot engage in that because we don't want that in our son. We have to work to get it off of us. Anyway, my son was about 4. Turned 5, never mentioned it. Turned 6, never said a word. Turned 7, and I'm thinking, well, maybe it's not there. Never came up again. About 7 and a half, my husband's driving down I-25. Someone cuts him off, and my husband just simply said, idiot. And my son said, Dad, was he an Asian? Do you see how it gets recorded? It's there. People, friends, it's there. It's recorded there. We have to be aware of it. We have to understand how this promotes inequality in our society. And we have to understand it so that we can begin to work on it because a lot of this is unconscious. We don't know we have these things until we're under stress. Kent McIntosh has done some wonderful work on implicit bias and how it shows up at vulnerable decision-making points. It shows up when we're most stressed. This is what happens, and we have to know it so we can work to get rid of it. How does it impact preschool? Walter Gillian, he's always on the cutting edge. I just love him. He just conducted last year a study on implicit bias in preschool classrooms. And he found that preschool teachers judge children's behaviors differently based on the race of the child. And what he did, he took preschoolers and he asked them to watch a video clip. And there were 4 children, a black girl, white girl, black boy, girl. Did I say that right? 4. You all get it. So this is exactly what he said to them. We're interested in learning about how teachers detect challenging behavior in the classroom. Sometimes this involves seeing behavior before it becomes problematic. The video segments you're about to view are of preschoolers engaging in various activities. Some clips may or may not contain challenging behaviors. Your job is to press the enter key on the keypad every time you see a behavior that could be a potential challenge. What he didn't know was that the children were all actors. What the participants didn't know, they were all actors. There was no challenging behaviors.
And they also used eye-tracking devices so that they could see what children were being watched the most. And these are the results. The black boy was watched more than any other child. And 42% of teachers reported that he required more attention than the other children. The black girl was watched more often than white children. The white children were watched less than the black children overall. The results were true for both black and white teachers. And I just want to put this on the table because people always say, well, I'm black people, bias against blacks, and blah, blah, blah. Listen, we all breathe the same air. We're all impacted by this, all of us. We cannot deny that we are all biased. So when we look at what happens, we have to understand that we find behavior in the place that we're looking for it. My grandmother used to always say, if you look at a white sheet long enough, you're bound to find a spot, right? When you're looking in one place, you're gonna see it a little bit more. You're gonna see that. I'm working in a program right now, and I was observing the classroom, and there was a teacher sitting right here at a table. There was another table across the room and another table here. There were two little white guys sitting right next to her, doing what little boys do when they've been sitting too long. Hit, touch, just doing all kind of little things. But her mind was on the little black child across the table. She must have called her name 10 times and never noticed the little boys right there, right next to her. Later on, I asked her what was going on because we talked about it. And she said that that little girl tends to get in trouble. So she was looking for trouble. And when you look for trouble in the place where it's most likely to happen in your mind, then you will find it every single time. This is my son. And he is Clarence Allen III. And you probably know by now that I share a lot about myself, good, bad, and ugly. So I'm gonna tell you something that's way probably too personal, but I'll share it anyway. He was my 9th pregnancy, and I only have 2 children. He was the prayer of everyone in our family. At the time that I got pregnant with him, I was 35 and my husband was 45. And my husband's the baby of his family. So this little boy was the last chance that we had to even carry on the family name. At the time that I got pregnant, his grandfather, Clarence Allen Sr., was diagnosed with cancer. And the greatest prayer was that he would live long enough to see his namesake be born. So here he is as a little baby. This prayer manifested in this little boy. And as you can imagine, he was everything to us. Born prematurely, then later diagnosed with sensory integration processing issues, but he was and is the light of our lives. And I love this picture of him because if you look closely, he's holding a little red Lego. And he had to have this Lego everywhere he went and with everything he did. He ate with it, he slept with it, everywhere we went, he had to have that little Lego. And when I look at this picture and I see the statistics, he could have easily been one of them. Just imagine a teacher who didn't know him, who would take his Lego so he could eat. That would have disrupted his entire day. This is him now. And as you heard in my bio, last May he graduated from Howard University and he's at home now applying for law schools. But I wanted you to kind of see a face to these statistics that we talk about. For a teacher to get him in his classroom, we're turning over the most precious person in our lives for generations who has some special needs, who needs some special attention, but what child doesn't? And for teachers not to know him, not to know how far we came with him, not to know how many babies were lost trying to get him, and to think that he could end up suspended, kicked out, perhaps simply because you took his red Lego and he didn't know how to recover from that. So we have to be mindful of stereotypes, because only one person in this picture. To wrap up. you to really be aware of your personal attitudes, especially around challenging behaviors. What are your own hot buttons? Because a hot button for me might not be a hot button for you. A hot button for me in my home, my daughter is brilliant. She is one of the most brilliant minds I've ever seen. And you know what happens with brilliant minds? Come brilliant mouths. That can be extremely hard to tackle. So with her brilliant mouth, she was always smarting off, always had something to say, always, always, always. Even little things that she didn't have to get involved with. I remember I was at a field trip with her, and the teacher told this little guy, Philip, to do something. And she said to Philip, "Philip, fill up the last row." And my daughter interjects, "Do you mean fill up the last row or fill up the last row?" I'm like, that doesn't even concern you. Mind your business. But that was my hot button, her mouth. It didn't bother my husband one bit. She could say anything and it didn't bother him. But the minute that she would slam a door, he would go nuts. One time he said, "If you slam the door one more time, I'm gonna take it off the hinges." And as I said in my TED talk, the slamming the door didn't bother me because it meant she was on the other side of it. I didn't have to hear her back. So she slammed the door one day and he took the hinges off. But those were his hot buttons. We all have different hot buttons. And I like to say behavior is defined by the person most annoyed by it. Because what bothers some doesn't bother others. And when we look at our hot buttons, we have to wonder about cultural disconnects, because we talked about that a little earlier on. Most children don't come to school knowing the teacher's expectations of them. When I was at home, the things that I did that my family thought was cute and funny got me in trouble at school. My dad thought I was brilliant. My sister made me mad and I buried her shoes in the backyard. He thought that was the funniest thing he'd ever heard in his entire life. I went to school and dug a hole in the playground to see if China was on the other side, and I got suspended. You see? So we don't always know, children don't always know what we expect of them, and teachers often do not know the cultural expectations of the child at home. This could be the child's very first experience with people outside of their immediate family, who look like them, who talk like them, who share the same values and expectations. They come to our schools and they don't know what the expectations are. It's like walking on foreign land. That happened to me too when I went from the public sector to working in government. All of a sudden, I was in a whole different world. There were different rules, different words, acronyms for everything, right? So, this may also be differences in the child's family expectations and the teacher's expectations. And when that happens, there are cultural disconnects. And these disconnects lead to disproportionality and disciplinary practices. We have to understand, and I said it a million times, I say it a million times, different is not deficit. It's just different. When I went to South Africa, the people didn't drive on the wrong side of the road. However, they did drive on the other side of the road. Now, if I would have gone there and thought this is wrong and started driving on the right side of the road, it would have created chaos. I probably wouldn't be here to talk to you today. It's not different, it's deficit. So when we look at things, we have to talk about culture, and we have to understand what culture is. And for the purposes of this talk, culture is the way of being. It's not race and ethnicity, it's just the way of being. I was born and raised in Los Angeles, lived in Colorado 23 years, I have found that rodeo is its own culture. Its very own culture is just the most amazing thing, and it has helped me to redefine culture over and over again. But culture is the way we live, our values, mores and customs, our behavioral expectations, our belief systems, our communication styles, and traditions that are shared and passed between generations. Many, many children come to school as first-time Americans, first-time people living here. And the culture that they will experience will be different from the culture of their parents, but the traditions are shared. Culture impacts the way that children learn, cope, solve problems, and communicate. And when we view the child through this cultural lens, then we can have an understanding of the factors that influences a child's behavior. So, I just want you to take a look at this little girl that I fall in love with. Oops. Let me go back. Thank you. And when you're watching this clip, what I want you to do is think about how this child might present in a classroom and wonder if classrooms will be ready for who she is.
With you on your level. And if you know anything about beauty salons, isn't that a beauty salon conversation? It's just amazing. Everywhere we go, especially at school, we have to understand there's a culture that exists, a culture that we bring, and a culture that's created. So the cultural background that we bring with us, our beliefs and perceptions, our own personal attitudes, and our cultural practices. And you can see all three of those just in that little toddler. Those beliefs and perceptions, that is tripping. Personal identities, boy, does she have a lot of personality, and cultural practices. So, this is my cultural tree, and it replaced that iceberg that we used to see all over the place. And I like the tree only because it has deep roots, and I think it's pretty closely tied to culture. But at the branch and the leaves, what we see in terms of culture is dress, music, food. But at the roots, what's really unseen and rarely discussed are our habits and assumptions, our understandings, our values and judgments, the nature of friendships. I'll tell you something. In my family, best friends become uncles and aunties to your children, and their friends become cousins. And they become part of extended families. It was so much so that my sister fell in love with my mother's
best friend's son, and they couldn't date, a little dating that they would have done at 12, because they were cousins. That's how that fictive kinship really becomes very serious in some families. The tone of voice, the attitude towards elders, the concept of cleanliness, patterns of group decision making, all of this is part of our culture. I went to my girlfriend's daughter's wedding last month, and even growing up, my girlfriend was a little OCD, but now it's manifested in ways that are just really interesting. I stayed at her house, and I was afraid to touch anything. I made a little shake, because I drink little shakes in the morning, and I asked where the towels were to wash it out, and she goes, "I don't use dish towels, they carry germs. Here, use a paper towel." And I said, "Okay, where's the trash can? I don't keep trash in the house. What do I do with this?" And I'll take it out. Concept of cleanliness is really, 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 really different. And I'm thinking, next time you come to my house, you're going to see dish towels and the trash can. So, and the preference for competition or cooperation and how people problem solve. But what's at the trunk that's sometimes discussed? Concepts of time. No, I don't want to get into a little bit. There are people who are governed by a clock, temporal. And there are other people who are governed by relationships. And for people who are governed by relationships, things don't start until everyone is there. So when you think some people are habitually late, that's because you're looking at a clock and they're looking at people. I had a really great conversation last night. I thought I saw him over here with Ted. There you are in Hawaii. And we talked about the concept of time. It's so different. Island time is different. So we have to understand that everyone doesn't have the same concept of time. So if you're working directly with children and you think they're always coming to school late, that you can't change the clock because schools operate by a clock, but that is not the time, first thing in the morning, to give out the most pertinent information. You may just want to wait until 30 minutes when you're sure everybody's going to be there so everyone gets the same information at the same time. Personal space, huge, huge. Personal space, I was watching a comedian from India, and I'm going to ask you to come up so you can help me to demonstrate this. And he was talking about personal space. When he first came to the States, he would close up space because in India, there are a lot of people. So what he would do is get in line. So he's in line at the bank. He's in line at the bank, and he would just get in line. And then the person would step up. And then he would get in line. And the person would step up. And he would step up. Thank you so much. And all of a sudden, the person turned around and yelled at him, "What are you doing? Back off!" And he had no idea what he was doing wrong, because he was making space for the next person based on his own culture and cultural beliefs. Rules of conduct, facial expressions, nonverbal communications. So what we have to do in order to address this disconnect between culture and behavior and expectations and things we know and things we don't know and implicit bias is that we have to embrace culturally responsive practices. And what are culturally responsive practices? It's making sure the child and the family is at the center of every single thing we do. That we're aware of what we bring in. We understand it. What I bring in is that children speak. What I bring in is that children answer me by saying yes. What I bring with me is that children address me with a title. That's what I bring in. But then I have to look at the reality. These children I work with, they answer me by saying what? And it doesn't make them bad or disrespectful. It's different. So who needs to adjust? Do they need to adjust? Or do I need to adjust? And the reality is that children should not be adjusting to us. Families shouldn't be adjusting to us. We should be making that adjustment. It's up to us to do that. Why would we expect a three-year-old to adjust to my cultural preferences, needs, desires, and values, and most of the time they don't even know what they are? So, the first thing, principle one, kids get it that we get them. in our classrooms, in our offices, everywhere we go, children and their families are represented in routines and activities, stories, people, visuals. Children feel recognized and seen. Principle two, they get it that we like them. Believe me, children understand the difference between what we say and how we present it. Facial expressions, gestures, tones of voice, they pay more attention to that than what we're saying and doing. They understand that we enjoy them, we have comfortable conversations about them, about their cultural traditions and their activities, and we have we develop meaningful relationships, and I have a typo in there, with each and every child. School looks like me, our offices look like me. Wherever we are, we see ourselves in photos and family books, bulletin boards, pictures, games. They reflect the culture of the children. And when all the children are white, then we still present this so they can see that the world doesn't necessarily look like their classrooms. Children's work is attractively displayed. Principle four, we catch children being good. Children's development and efforts are reinforced. We see them through a strength-based lens, and we try to understand their behavior from that lens. We look for, the operative word here is we look for and acknowledge positive behavior. We seek it out. We don't look for the negative. And children are perceived as smart and capable learners. Five, strategies are adjusted to meet the unique learning style and cultural styles of children. Like I said earlier, some cultures prefer cooperative play over competitive play. Some children need to get up and move around. Most children need to get up and move around a lot. Some, like the little girl in the video, she's gonna talk. If you wanna teach her anything, sit her in a dramatic play area and let her comb your hair, right? Because that would work for her. Children don't have to change who they are to fit into our programs. Creating program-wide rules so that they're consistent with the family's cultural expectations and using strategies that are congruent with the child's family and communities. Principle six, guidance is caring and consistent. That means that children are not discriminated against based on who's engaged in the behavior. Children are intentionally taught rules and they're consistently applied all the time. Expectations are clear, they're implemented consistently and reinforced regularly. And guidance is not punitive, but it's instructive. Principle seven, child-centered learning. Friendship skills are taught and reinforced. Do you know that as an adult, I was never taught how to make a friend? There are many people in this room who have no idea how you make friends. You want to get to know people better. Anybody else struggle with that? We struggle. And teachers individualize instruction based on the needs of the child, and teachers support peers in helping their friends learn and practice social skills. So, as we wrap up, culturally responsive practices are the lens through which teachers see children and their learning, the filter through which teachers listen to how children express their needs and desires, and the mode in which teachers interact with children using curricular materials and making educational decisions. What can you do in your practice to address this issue that I believe is a civil rights issue, one of the most serious today, of children who are being denied access to education through suspensions and expulsions? And then I'll end by playing my very favorite video. Thank you.
She didn't understand what was going on. And she said her son, who was white, he got in much more trouble, but he never got suspended. He even set a fire at school and wasn't suspended. And she asked me if I thought it might have something to do with race. And I had to say it could. But Daniel was very active. He came into my office on the 11th floor. He looked down and he goes, "Hey, that's the number 81 bus down there. How do you know?" He goes, "See that McDonald's? See this, see that? That means that's the 81 and that's where it's going." "Okay." And then he said toward the end of my interview with Grandma, hey lady, can you read me a book?" And I'm looking like we have to go. And I said, "I'll tell you what, I can read half the book. And Grandma, will you read the other half when you get home?" She goes, "Sure." This little guy took the book, said, "I gotta count the pages first." 4 years old, counting pages. And then he goes, "Okay, so how much is half of that?" I'm thinking, okay, you know half. So we started, and it was a book about how the turtle got his shell. And I said, "This book is how the turtle got his shell." And David goes, I know, let me tell you what I think. And I couldn't get through a page without him interjecting. And I'm sitting here watching this brilliant boy, and I realize why he's being suspended. Because he's just brilliant, and he's active, and he has a lot to say. So I talked to the grandma, I read half the book, and it was time to go. And I walked them to the door, and they started down the long hallway. And he wouldn't let go of my hand. And I said, "Well, it's time to go, sweet pie." He goes, "Will you pray for me first?" I'd never been asked to do that. And I didn't know if it was okay. But I looked at the grandma, and she goes, "It's okay with me." So I took his hand, and I said, "Dear God, as David starts his new school on Monday, help the teacher see his brilliance.
difference. Help them see his genius. Help them see his heart. And help them to have the best time ever. Amen. And he wouldn't let go of my hands. He goes, you forgot. I said, I forgot what? He said, you forgot. I said, tell me what I forgot. He said, you forgot to pray that I'll be good. And that broke my heart. And as I close, I just want to say to you that these are all of our children. And we will either profit by or pay for who they become. Thank you very much.